Good afternoon and welcome to the annual SJ Hall Lecture in Industrial Forestry. My name is Bill Stewart. I'm a CE specialist and the director of the Center for Forestry and also a member of the Cal Alumni Foresters. Before the program begins, I would like to just draw your attention to some general rules of civility. As we all know, we're kind of the home of the free speech movement, but I want you to honor that commitment so that by allowing all our speakers and all the other audience members that are asking questions to enjoy today's presentation without interruption. If you have any questions, there's been some piece of paper on your table, on the chairs next to you. If you write the questions down, raise your hand, our runners will pick those up so we can actually organize those and get them answered, and so that Mark can answer as many as he has time to after it. As you all know, if everyone can turn off their cell phones, or at least get it on vibrate, so that only you get vibrated on this one. And so the lecture will be videotaped and with the sound, so we will have this posted on the CNR website, hopefully as soon as we can actually get all the digital files over there. So please remain in your seats so that everyone can see the speaker while you're doing this, and please refrain from engaging any actions that disrupt the event and kind of confuse, I think, the presentation and the dialogue we're gonna have afterwards. So thanks very much for your consideration. And now with that, I'd like my pleasure is to introduce our Dean, Keith Gillis from the College of Natural Resources. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill. You can always tell a really active cooperative extension person because their voice is always dicey. Bill gave 3 talks in one day this week and he lost his voice. So welcome to the S.J. Hall Lecture on Industrial Forestry. I'm Keith Gillis, Dean of the College of Natural Resources and a professor of forest economics when I'm doing what I really love. I've got the great honor of introducing our guest speaker tonight, who I have a great deal of respect for and have had the pleasure of getting to know over the years when he's been in a variety of venues associated with our forestry program and with the university in a greater sense. Before I do that, though, I'd like to give some information on the S.J. Hall Lecture Series. The first gift to set up a lecture in honor of S.J. Hall on the campus was made in 1968. So this is a 40-year-old tradition we're participating in tonight. Desi Hall and the Forest Economics Foundation went on to endow both this lectureship and a chair in forest economics. The S.J. Hall Chair in Forest Economics, a chair I've had the privilege of holding as a member of the Berkeley faculty during my career here. We're very fortunate that Desi had the foresight and the generosity and the capacity to establish this endowed funds, which now allow us to do this on an annual basis and continue to provide a public forum for research in forest management and economics and discussion of the issues of the day in that field. I'd like to take a moment this afternoon to recognize the members of the Hall family who've made it their tradition to continue to participate in this annual event. The Halls, Susan, David, Dorothy, and their son Kenneth, and regularly his partner Patty Dilko and their friend Kate Williams-Brown have come to us over many times here. We really enjoy your participation. We're glad to keep the tie alive to the Hall family. I'd also like to thank Charles Spinetta of Charles Spinetta Winery in Amador County, who donated the wine for the reception and dinner we'll be having later. A couple quick housekeeping details. The reception following the talk will be in the garden patio out this way. Everyone who's here is welcome to attend the reception. We will need any guests that are just here for the lecture to leave the reception by 6:15 because we'll be having the California Alumni Foresters annual dinner after that, and that's a business meeting and private dinner. And as Bill said, at the end of the talk here, we'll have plenty of time for questions and answers. I'll moderate that discussion, so please, as thoughts occur to you, write them down in the cards, and I'll try and do my best to express your question in a coherent fashion. Now, I'd like to introduce Mark Emmerson, a 1982 graduate of the Haas School of Business, and a very strong Golden Bear fan. Had the pleasure of being at a football game with him where he kept taunting a supporter from the University of Oregon with texts about the relative comfort he and I were in under a canopy while it poured rain. on his friend who is down with the team. Mark's the CFO and a member of the board of directors of the Redding, California-based Sierra Pacific Industries, one of the nation's leading lumber, millwork, and window manufacturers. They manage 1.8 million acres of industrial forest land. Mark serves on the board of directors of the California Forestry Association. He is a member of the UC President's Advisory Commission on Agriculture and Natural Resources. Those of you that know the Sierra Pacific Industries know that really the touchstone of their firm is hard work and commitment to maintaining a family atmosphere among their employees, 3,500 of them, and that those principles govern their day-to-day operations. Many of our alums are proud to be employed by Sierra Pacific Industries, and I have to say our research community has more than once been seriously in their debt. There was a period where we were faced with canceling probably the most important experiment in atmospheric chemistry related to forests in the world over difficulties getting 10 different universities to agree to procedures and guidelines and regulations on risk management issues. And at the last minute, Sierra Pacific not only built us a fence around the flux tower where we were doing these experiments, but also gave us extraordinary access to private land in support of the scientific mission of the university. And I will always be very grateful to them for that action. Mark, with no further ado, the podium is yours.
Well, good afternoon, Keith. Thank you very much. I really am honored to be here, to be asked to speak to you folks today. And I sincerely mean it when I want to thank you all for taking the time to be here. It's a great opportunity for me to talk about our company and also talk about modern industrial forestry, which is so often misunderstood. Today, I don't think the average American knows the difference between a national park and a national forest. A lot of people believe that the national forest or our forests should look like the city park. We have this Disneyland image of what a forest is, and a lot of emotion. Today, what I hope to accomplish is to educate you folks on at least our thoughts, our reasons, our science, why we manage our forests the way we do. I also want to talk a little about regulation in California. These are some of the applications we file. We'll talk about those a little bit later. If someone would have told me 25 years ago how much time I'd be spending with regulators, legislators, and their staffs, I wouldn't have believed it. And if I did, I probably would have changed careers. It's incredible. In Sacramento today, every 2 years, we have 1/3 of the assembly changing. Can you imagine running your business or your organization if every 2 years, 1/3 of your senior staff had to leave? You'd have inexperienced people making decisions. It'd be a mess. And that's just about what we have in Sacramento today. And also, what I hope you'll see from my presentation is that we're very passionate and very proud of what we do. It is a family business. And I believe the best possible ownership structure for a forest, a very long-term asset, and we make very long-term decisions. The trees that we plant today, I'll never see in a sawmill. And we're not concerned about quarterly earnings per share. We do have compliance certificates that we file with bank on a quarterly basis, but we just look at our business differently, much differently than a publicly traded corporation. I'm also very proud to say that the first member of the fourth generation, my nephew Garrett Emmerson, is working for the company. He just started. He's a Cal grad, or a UC grad. Didn't go to Cal, but anyway. But this afternoon, I'm going to start with the brief history of Sierra Pacific, go over what I think are some of the real tipping points in our company's growth, talk a little bit about technological changes in manufacturing lumber in my career, and then finish up with a few comments on China. And if anyone's still here and not asleep in 3 or 4 hours when I finish, I'd be happy to answer questions. And now here's the disclaimer. Your dean has asked, the dean of the School of Natural Resources has asked an accountant to speak to forestry professionals on forestry issues. I'm not sure that makes any of us very smart, but I guess we'll see how it goes. So, to get started here, the roots of Sierra Pacific really go back to my grandfather. This is Raleigh Humes Emmerson, known as Curly. He was born in Milwaukee in 1900, about 10 years later, moved to Oregon with his family, and then graduated. When he graduated from his formal education in the eighth grade, it was about the beginning of World War I. A tough time for a unskilled, inexperienced kid to get a job, but he could get work in a sawmill, and that's what he started. About 10 years later, he met his wife-to-be, my grandmother. They got married, and within a few years, there were five of them living in about a two-room shack. Apparently, family life was a little much for my grandfather, so he pretty much bailed on his wife, divorced, and left the family, moving to Humboldt County in about the mid-40s. It really wasn't until 1948 that my father, when he graduated from high school, joined his father, and they had some success. This is my father. He's 82 years old, still extremely active in our company and active in general. He just shot an elk last weekend. But in a lot of ways, this is his story. It really is. He, you know, has barely a high school education, but I'd say he has a PhD in real business. So anyway, he joined his father in 48, and they leased a sawmill. Back then, it was a real, you can imagine, hand-to-mouth existence. Buy some logs, hire a few folks, manufacture some lumber, sell it, and hopefully you ended up with more money than you started with. But they were pretty good at it. My father and grandfather, they had some success. They really developed a culture of doing more with less. And in about 1950, they were able to purchase a mill here in Samoa. This operation is still in existence. Of course, we don't have a teepee burner today. Quite a bit different than it used to look like. But it's still in operation. And they were good. They were pretty good at what they did. With the help of another partner, they were able to acquire additional plants in Trinity, Lassen, and Humboldt County, and also build a mill down on the east side of the Sierra. But what really contributed to their success was Red's mechanical knack. He could see bottlenecks in the operation and fix them on generally a pretty cheap way. And he still is damn good at it today. So now it's the late 60s, and you know, they put together some pretty efficient operations. Not pretty, but extremely efficient. Able to take in resources at a, you know, and get lumber out in a very efficient manner. And my grandfather was pretty content at the time. He thought that he and his son and their partner, the Crook family, they'd put together a pretty nice little company. Had about 700 employees at this time and was pretty happy. My father still wanted to grow the company. And so he came up with the idea that if they went public, they'd be able to access additional markets for liquidity and expansion. So it really wasn't until 1969 that Sierra Pacific came into existence. My family, along with the Crook family, put in family assets, each company or each family keeping 40%, and 20% was traded on the American Stock Exchange. This is a picture from the 72 annual report. That's my father right there. I'm really not too sure why they're smiling. Almost from the beginning, it was like a bad marriage. Different views, different cultures, it just didn't work out. My father thought shareholders meetings were a waste of time, and why in the hell would you ever have a distribution when you need so much money for the capital expenditures? But and he pretty much still feels that way today. But anyway, you know, and John wanted to go in different areas. He wanted to diversify into non-wood related areas. They ended up opening some hardware stores. They bought a plant in Chicago that made inexpensive paneling for mobile homes and opened up some distribution centers on the East Coast. By about 1972, all the money being made in the sawmills was being lost in the other ventures. So at that point, my father wanted out. He went to Louisiana Pacific and started to negotiate a buyout of the company, but it fell apart when Red wouldn't go to work for them. He wanted his own company. So in 1973, he went to his partner at the time and said, either you buy me out or I'm going to buy you out. And pretty shortly thereafter, ended up owning a company with the book value of about $8 million and $25 million of debt. It was time to get working. Today, my father views this as probably the riskiest, best business decision of his career. So they kept their head down and you know, continued to make lumber as a private company. In 1978, Publishers Paper decided to sell their California assets. And with the three sawmills came 87,000 acres of timberland. This is the real first purchase of timberland for the company. It just seemed like a perfect fit. It was inventory. It had to be financed. And about the same time, the company ventured into the millwork business. That's taking industrial or shop lumber, cutting out the defects, running it through molders for trim for windows, doors, that type of thing. It was also a good fit, just some vertical integration. So now we're in the mid-80s, and Sierra Pacific is the largest purchaser of Forest Service timber in the country. We had purchased some timberland, about 100,000 acres, but that was providing just a small fraction of what the sawmills needed. But that was okay. 70% was coming from the Forest Service, and the trees are going to continue to grow in California. There's 12 million acres of Forest Service timber. You're going to be okay with that, right? Well, along came the spotted owl, and this really changed things. It is just amazing how much we didn't know. We learned a lot. And when I say we, the whole industry, and probably a better term would be we were schooled. We couldn't answer the simple questions. How many are there? What's its habitat? What does it want? It was a disaster. It was really the beginning of the failure of the Forest Service program. In 1989, lawsuits were filed alleging that the species was in danger of going extinct and need to be protected. An interagency task force was formed with Jack Ward Thomas, I'm sure you folks remember him, and they concluded there needed to be 900 pair well-distributed in the range of the spotted owl, which is essentially Canada to here. So remember that, 900 pair. And this is a graph of the Forest Service timber sale program. Again, you can see 1988, 2.2 billion feet, down to today where it's about 100 million feet. The current allowable harvest is about 500 million feet, and not even close to the mortality. I don't know what it's growing. It's 12 million acres, probably growing. It's several billion feet. But anyway, you can see that the program crashed by reducing it by 95%. But right in about the same time, 1987, right when the spotted owl was becoming known to everybody, we had another opportunity facing us. Santa Fe and Southern Pacific Railroads had merged, and a decision had been made to get rid of their lands in California. They had a fairly significant timber sale program going on at the time, and we participated in, bought probably 60% of it. So it was a significant supply of resources for us. So we really made a pretty much bet the farm decision and borrowed almost $500 million to acquire the 522,000 acres. The banks must have been crazy. That was several times the value of the company. But this acquisition really changed our company and our profile. No longer were we just a manufacturer, but now we were a major landowner in California. And along with this acquisition came a pretty sophisticated forestry department. We probably didn't appreciate it at the time, but they would help us significantly in additional acquisition opportunities. I mean, they had wildlife biologists, GIS mapping abilities, and just a general incredible inventory database system also. And here's a list of our significant acquisitions for about the last 25 years. You can see a lot of the names I'm sure you folks recognize, probably maybe some you don't. But what does it take to evaluate these acquisitions? It's kind of interesting. Obviously, you have to know how much timber is out there. So we send a bunch of folks out there and do a cruise. And then we have to, so once we determine what the volume of that land is, then you have to sift it through the current state regulations. What can you harvest? And on these acquisitions of size, you don't look at it for 1 year. This is an ongoing program. So you have to look at it through today's regulations, which you know are going to be changing in the future. Once you do that, then you determine the harvest level and the trees that are going to be coming off. And then we take and we put those trees through our sawmills to determine what the lumber is going to be. Different species of and different size diameters create much different products, significantly different in value. So then from that, we take it and we determine what it's going to be, you know, according to the price levels. So it's just a discounted cash flow method with a lot of assumptions. And what really makes it difficult is the price of lumber. This is a pretty interesting graph. This is like the forever price of lumber for about the last 120 years. And you can see right down here, actually in May of 2009, we faced the lowest lumber prices ever. It's quite an interesting time to live through, but it wasn't a lot of fun, but it makes for a good story. Even lower than the Depression. I mean, this down here are, you know, lower than a $250 sales average. Right now, the prices are about $300 and something we can probably live with. But you can see just the significant volatility. So when you're trying to evaluate one of these acquisitions, it's easy to know what it's going to cost. Today in financing, we can pin it down to almost the exact dollar how much that timberland is going to cost to ship, to hold. But it's the revenue generation that's tough. And then the reality comes in. So you do that formal appraisal, then you generally put it on the shelf and you say, okay, what's it going to take to buy it? What's the competition going to do? What are we going to have to do? You know, who is it close to us? Is there going to be a lot of competition on it? Do we really need this land? Is it very strategic? And also something that's kind of interesting, and that is in the mid-80s, when we really got into the timberland acquisition game, almost all of the timberland at the time was owned by publicly traded, vertically integrated C corporations, likes of International Paper, LP, GP. But Wall Street doesn't really give those firms credit for their timberland. They have it at historical cost, depleted for the harvest. In about the early 90s, Georgia Pacific tried to get that value recognized by issuing a separate letter stock, which was a failure. Today, GP lands are owned by Plum Creek, which is undoubtedly the most successful private REIT in the forest products industry. So we benefited when these companies said timberland was no longer a core asset. And I don't know, we certainly appreciate the fact that they didn't think it's a core asset. We think it is. And although we do own 1.7 million acres in California, it's still an ongoing challenge to wood these operations. A little over 10 years ago, we were having a particularly tough time in our Sonora mill, which is down in Central California. We ended up hauling logs from the middle of Washington, 800 miles on unit trains, to wood our mill in Sonora. Now, that doesn't work very well. But what happened here is that in the 80s and 90s, there was an extremely strong export market. As that export market dwindled in the 2000 or so, the manufacturing capacity in the area had also dwindled. So there was about 400 million feet of logs looking for homes. So we put those logs, we took some down to California, but instead of moving the logs to California, we decided to put a mill up in Washington. And here's a picture of our sawmill in Aberdeen, Washington, built in about 2002. It has a capacity right at 300 million board feet. And we're the general contractor and do all the design work in-house on these facilities. Again, it's a culture of probably doing more with less. We also have a reputation of doing more in-house work. And this is a photograph of our fabrication shop. We started building this fabrication shop in 1987. When we built our mill in Anderson. All of our mills have the ability to do maintenance, but we really take it to the next level here with CNC machining capabilities and PLC skills and design engineers. We have 50 folks working in that shop today, and it really helps us get the biggest dollar from our capital expenditures. And when we have breakdowns, we have people that we can immediately set in motion to fix them, because unfortunately we do have breakdowns in these industrial facilities. So with the success of our Aberdeen operation, we decided to build another one. This is now in Burlington, up in northern Washington. And again, we were the general contractor and did all the design work in-house. We like to make our own mistakes. And this facility also has a capacity of about 300 million board feet. So this is a map of pretty much all of our holdings in Washington. Again, you can see the mill in Aberdeen, our first one, then the mill in Burlington. And then in 2006, we purchased a mill in Centralia. That was a pretty good facility. The original owner was just undercapitalized. It was only 1 year old when we purchased it, and it's been a very good addition to our operation. Also, two timberland acquisitions, our Hamilton tree farm up here and down Riderwood, total of around 233,000 acres. And here's a similar slide for California, again, with the plants located around and also the timberland. In California, it's a little different than Washington. We use 100% of the logs that we harvest. In Washington, we sell the oversize and the off-specie. But in California, we use 100%. But we specialize in large and small log mills, such as Anderson would be a small log mill. Shasta Lake is a large log mill. The difference being that a small log mill, similar to Washington, is pretty simple. It's like making hamburger. It's a very consistent product. 90% of the product is two and better dimension lumber that you're going to build a house out of. Very, very different than the products that come from a large log mill. In the small log mill, we'll have a sales average today of around $300. In the large log mill, we manufacture products such as 5/4 by 12 stepping, which is worth $3,300 per 1,000 board feet, 11 times as much. So it's very important that we're able to get the high value out of the large logs. I look at it as, again, small log mills, hamburgers, and in the large log mills, we've got to get the fillet out. One thing I haven't mentioned is that another aspect of our business, and that's cogeneration. It's cogeneration because we put superheated steam through a turbine generating electricity, then extract it further down the process and use that steam for drying lumber. It really is a wonderful system for us. I mean, we really like it. We generate, or we in a sawmill, you're going to generate about four different byproducts: sawdust, which is usually the least expensive, shavings, bark, and chips. In California, there's no operating pulp mills today. So if we sell chips, they have to travel several hundred miles north. With a cogeneration facility, we can burn the cheapest byproduct and then sell the most valuable ones. It's surprising, when I first started working at Sierra Pacific, bark was worthless. Today, at times, it's our most valuable product used for landscaping. It depends where we are, how far it is to a urban area. We really like the cogeneration. It is a wonderful fit for a sawmill. A sawmill has about a 4 megawatt demand, and we have the byproduct there for the fuel, and we like to ship our byproducts through the utility lines. It is really a good fit for a sawmill. I kind of say it's like the lawnmower that runs on grass. So here's pretty much everything in our company. We've got 14 sawmills, a little over 2 billion feet of production, millwork plants about 160 million feet, 250,000 units of windows production, and 1.1 million megawatt hours of electricity. We do this all with our timberland and 3,600 employees and a payroll of just under $200 million. So now I want to take a few minutes and talk about, without a doubt, what's the more controversial aspect of our business, and that's forest management. And as I mentioned in my disclaimer, I'm not a forester, but I think I've picked up a few things in the last 25 years. But I'm going to go over some very basic concepts here to try to set the groundwork for where we're going. And I think it's important that we all understand that in the last 100 years, we have really changed the forest. Mainly have done this through putting fires out, fire prevention. In the last 100 years, we got pretty good at it. But as we did that, we changed the density and also changed the species mix to predominantly shade-tolerant species like white fir and cedar. And we have about a 10,000-year history in California of putting out fires, or of having fires, both natural and man-made. Even Native Americans understood the value of managing the forest for improved wildlife habitat. And I believe today we should continue to put out fires. I don't want to live in the smoke environment that we've experienced in Shasta County in previous summers. But that's only half the solution. We can't just put fires out and not mechanically remove the vegetation. Otherwise, the fuel loading becomes so great that when a fire does start, it becomes catastrophic. And that's exactly what we have now today in our national forests. And remember that graph of what we're harvesting back in Region 5, 100 million feet? We're growing 20 to 30 times that much. So getting back to our specific management practices, again, most of our land's in California. And earlier, when I talked about evaluating the acquisitions, I mentioned state regulations. California, without a doubt, has the most restrictive regulations in the country. This is an indisputable fact. Another fact, until just a few years, California had the largest appetite for lumber. And even though we have 20 million acres of highly productive private and public timber, 80% of the country's of the state's forest product needs come from places that have less stringent standards. Say, Oregon and Washington that do have standards, to maybe the southern south, the southern US and Canada, to third world countries that have no standards. I mean, it's kind of like environmental imperialism. So in California, to harvest a tree, you have to fill out what's called a timber harvest plan, or a THP. This is a CEQA document that includes cumulative impact analysis for all listed and non-listed species, including special interest plants. Examples would be northern spotted owl, California owl, northern goshawk, Pacific fisher, pine marten, Sierra Nevada red fox, amphibian and salmonoid surveys and rare plants. And this is just the biological survey. Then we do archaeological surveys. And how old would you guess an arc site is in California? Well, I turned into one about a year ago, 50 years. I say it's the garbage my grandfather left in the forest. And that's a real injustice to true arc sites that need to be and are protected. This document, the THP, then goes out for public comment and review, then goes through a multi-agency review team, which normally includes Department of Fish and Game, Mines and Geology, Regional Water Quality Control Boards, with CAL FIRE's lead agency, addressing all public comments. And for a company such as ours, because we have over 50,000 acres, we also have to have an overall plan called an Option A. And this document details our harvesting operations by decade for the next 100 years. I'm sure that there are other industries that plan that far out, but I'm not sure which they are. So the individual harvest plan has to comply with the overall option A. And these individual harvest plans, if everything goes right, takes 6 months to 2 years for approval with a cost of about $40,000. In Washington, for comparison, we file what's called a forest plan application. These are accomplished in about less than 3 months and about $6,000. And I'll never forget a conversation I had with a gentleman from Arkansas. I asked him, we were talking about forestry and operations. I said, what do you have to do to harvest your trees? He didn't understand the question. He said, you have to have a chainsaw. Don't you own them? And you know, that's really what he thought. So anyway, I mentioned some of the applications we file. Again, this is Oregon, 4 pages. This is Washington, 29 pages. And this is California. And I'd say that we do have more limitations in California, but are we really practicing better forestry on the ground? I don't think so. But the real controversy, that's controversial, but the real controversy comes when we get to our preferred harvesting method. Now, remember that list of acquisitions of timberland I had up there. If you remember, almost every acquisition was another lumber company or somebody else who had been previously harvesting on those lands. And almost every acre we own has been harvested on for about 125 years. So you can imagine that the early folks that came through, they took the best trees, left the rest. And that happened again and again. So now what we're left with in many cases are trees that were previously viewed as inferior and unacceptable for harvest. And at the same time this was happening, our forest was being converted to shade-tolerant species. Originally, our lands were probably 80% pine. Today, they're less than 25%. What we like to do is select an area of about 16 acres and cut down all the trees and essentially start over, really more of a restoration to the original forest. And then we plant 300 superior trees per acre. These aren't genetically modified, but the cones are selected from the best trees on our land. And we operate in 30 different geographic seed zones. You have to keep the seeds from this generally the same seed zone, and also pretty close to the same elevation, about 1,000 feet. So we have a very extensive seed collection program. And in a typical year, we'll plant 6 to 8 million trees. And today we get a 90% survival rate. And after planting the trees, in 85% of the clear cuts, we will go back a year after and use herbicides to kill back the grasses and brush to get the trees established. But in order to make sure that we're not doing any damage, we have voluntarily collected over 4,000 samples during and after the herbicide application and have yet to have any detectable violations. I mean, and this intensive forestry isn't suitable for all locations due to soil conditions, elevation, slope, etc. But probably close to 1.1 million of our 1.7 million acres in California, it is suitable. Another claim is made that this method of harvesting is least expensive. This is not true. The least expensive method would be to pluck around the forest, cutting a tree down here and there, and avoiding the preparation cost, the planting cost, and the herbicide application. We're making investments that we're not going to see a return from for 80 years. And earlier I mentioned that the whole industry was schooled by the spotted owl. We couldn't answer those questions. We're much better equipped today. On our California lands, we have collected information on over 400,000 plots. 30 years ago, we would have only collected information on the commercially viable species. But today, we evaluate the land for wildlife habitat characteristics. And this would include tree nests, wood rat nests. This is the most common food of the owl and other forest carnivores. And also look for wood loading, large woody debris, because this is the primary habitat for other species. And remember the 900 pair of widely distributed owls needed for a viable population. There are over 2,500 in California alone, and estimated well over 10,000 in the entire range. I gotta go back to this, okay. So this is a postcard that was handed out by Forest Ethics, not a group of friends of ours, in front of Home Depots. And here they allege that we're California's largest forest destroyer, using outdated logging practices, wrecking havoc on California's environment. And we actually toured these folks out the day they took this picture. We went out there with them trying to educate them on our practices. So anyway, you can kind of focus on these trees right here. So fast forward, there are these trees. This photograph again was taken on the same date. And there those trees are. You can see some snags here. This was taken 2 days ago. And you know, there you can see those trees. We've got some trees that must be 28, close to 30 feet tall here. Those are those two snags that you can see right here. And also, this is not some plantation forest. This has five species, five natural species, not genetically modified. I think it looks pretty good. Another thing that, about the same time period as this photograph here, there was a hit piece put out by the Planning and Conservation League. And I knew the director at the time. It said that we earned over $1 billion a year. Now, I wish that would have been true, but that's not. I called Jerry Merrill, the executive director at the time, and said, I knew him. I said, Jerry, what's this? And he said, well, I said, we've never grossed that much money. And he said, well, I read it somewhere. He said, sorry, you know, but it really didn't matter. Forest ethics also claims that our practices aren't sustainable. And you know, actually, they are right. Because if we were sustainable, we would stay down here. This is what our forest is doing. In the next 70 years, we'll triple the inventory in our forest. And not only are we're not tripling it with plantations, we're tripling it, and our tree size is gonna go up from 17 to 30 inches in diameter. It's 35 billion additional board feet. And if you're worried about climate change, that's close to 500 million tons of carbon dioxide pulled out of the atmosphere. We're really on the right side of this. I mean, if you're worried about climate change, you want to grow trees. And it really infuriates the environmental community. Now, earlier I mentioned that we have to do an option A where we determine what our harvest levels are going to be for the next 100 years. The next series of slides is a simulation of what a particular typical watershed would look like. And you can see this is decade by decade, starting in 1999. Harvesting and planting, trees grow back. Up to 1989 or 2089. And this is an actual photograph. And again, you can see the different age class. You can see the recent harvest, recent planted, other areas where the trees are available for harvest. And the 35 billion feet I talked about isn't pie in the sky. We're already seeing that in areas where we have traded with another landowner that started this in the early 70s. This is down in our Camino tract. We've gone from an annual harvest of 20 million feet to 28 million, and we're going to get close to 40 million board feet within a decade. One other thing I want to talk about here. These are about the same diameter. This tree is 56 years old. This tree is 8 years old. We want to grow these. Now, I'm sure there might be a question or two later about some of our harvesting practices, but I'm going to move on now to something that I think is real interesting. I'll talk a little bit about some of our technology. And specifically, I want to talk about scanning, positioning, and optimization. When I first started at Sierra Pacific 25 years ago, the scanning was extremely rudimentary. It was mechanical. There were wands that a piece of lumber would pass through. The wand would move down and determine the size of the board. It was horrible. The wands would get stuck. They'd break. The information was bad, you get bad solutions. After that, we went to using lights and cameras. The camera could pick up kind of the light, but it was more of a shadow effort where you'd put a light on the top of the log. You could see where the break was, kind of, but you had no information where the shadow, any information on the shadow portion of the log. You had to assume it was the same as the top. Again, bad information. Depending upon ambient light conditions, dark logs, it didn't work well at all. The next thing that really made a difference was lasers. A camera can easily pick up a laser. The pixels can definitely define where the laser point is. So when you know the exact distance from that camera to where that light is, you can determine the geometric shape of the log. And this made a big improvement. We finally could get very accurate measurements on the exterior dimensions. And this is the early 90s. So now we have this great data. What are we going to do with it? As I also mentioned here, it's positioning. If you think you're moving a board 2 inches and you move it 2.5, you're not going to get the right solution. So this is just a temposonic cylinder. This is used in industry today. In fact, it was pretty funny when I was looking for some diagrams. They quoted that it literally said it was used in all the way from aerospace to sawmill mills. So anyway, what it has here, it has a probe in the middle. And there's a magnetic position that stays with this probe. As a cylinder is extended, this magnet also moves. And then you send an electrical pulse down the probe. It hits the magnet, comes back, measured in millions of a second. But by measuring that, we know exactly the distance there. We use these hundreds, thousands of times a day, and we can measure them to within probably 3/1000ths of an inch. It really made a difference in knowing how being able to position our lumber. And then after that, now we've tried to get rid of hydraulics and go to motors. And the motors, essentially, it's the same type of theory where you're getting instantaneous data feedback on what this motor has done. They are extremely accurate. So what do we do with that? Well, here's an example of curve sawing. We are able to take now and, used to cut these straight. We actually now, if you have a C-shaped or a banana-shaped piece of wood, we will actually cut it along that. It's an extremely complicated algorithm to move it right at the right speed and to be able to move those arbors to get the lumber out. We can curve saw about 4 inches in 16 feet, and it takes a heck of a lot of horsepower. Some of these machines have upwards of 2,700 horsepower on them. But the idea is we get longer lumber. And also what's interesting is this lumber, when it comes out, it's on the table and it goes, you look at it and go, huh, who's gonna buy that? Well, the problem is you take this cant here and cut it straight. After it dries, the lumber wants to twist. You cut this along the center line and it dries much better. Another application of scanning is a quick video I'm going to show, and at least I hope I'm going to show. We'll see, you had a few technical difficulties earlier. But this is in our Aberdeen operation, and let's see if we're lucky here. Hey, there we go. So what's happening here? As you can see, it's being rotated. This is being scanned right there. We get a snap scan of it. It comes up, and we're going to rotate this up to 60 degrees, just a little bit right there to get increased recovery. This video is only 3 days old. We just put this machine up in our plant in Aberdeen, Washington. But again, all this equipment was built in-house and designed at Sierra Pacific. So far, we're estimating this is going to give us an improved recovery between 1% and 2%. And that's big. I mean, we'll pay for that. This is a $750,000 upgrade, and we'll pay for that in probably 4 months. But all of this data that we've seen so far, this scan, is only on the exterior. There's times when we want to see what's on the inside of the board. This is probably the most sophisticated lumber scanning, at least that I'm familiar with. This is in our millwork operation, and this is a chop scan machine. And here, we're going to see different layers of information. This, again, is just a red, green, blue camera, and just on the top and the bottom. This is a trachid scan. Here, a very intense, precise light is shined on the board, and it follows the cellulose fiber. So you can understand that it doesn't go through cracks. It's not going to go around knots. It moves differently. And then finally, I call this the MRI. This is where we're actually putting a radio frequency through the board. We have goes through the bottom, and then we have a receiver on the top of the board. And you can imagine that knots and other characteristics will, change the amount of energy that goes through that board. This is very sophisticated scanning. So we get this information, then all the data is handed off to another computer that crunches on this information for 40 seconds before we determine how we're going to manufacture this board. It takes 36 computers to run this line. And today we're using some of the same scanning technology in our final grading process in the sawmills. I've got just a few minutes left here, and I want to take and change subjects on you again, talk just a little bit about a recent trip I took to China. Probably close to a year ago, we started missing out on timber sales up in Washington to exporters. We've competed with exporters forever, and we will, that's fine. But we started missing a lot of sales. And so a gentleman and I said, what the heck, let's go to China and find out what we can. Let's see what's going on there. So we went into Shanghai, right here, and Shandong is really the lumber, at least the solid wood lumber capital of China. There, that's where all the lumber is being manufactured. And I don't know how many of you folks here have been to China, but it is just a contradiction. I was there with my girlfriend at the time, 26 years ago, and I remember arriving in Shanghai, and I think we rode some, three-wheeled golf cart to get into town. When I got there this time, we rode a train that did 400 kilometers an hour. Last time, there were bikes everywhere. This time, you'd be crazy if you were on a bike in that traffic. But and also, it's amazing to me, in China today, there's Audis, BMWs, and Mercedes being manufactured there for domestic consumption. There are a lot of nice cars. So I spent 1 week there touring ports, log yards, and sawmills. And 1 week in China hardly makes me any kind of an expert, but I just thought I'd share some of my thoughts on it. So first of all, and this is, I thought, surprising, China has quietly grown to be one of the major lumber manufacturers in the world. Number one in plywood, MDF, block board, which probably no one here is familiar with, it's junk, and number one in furniture, hardwood lumber number two, particle board three, and softwood lumber three also. I was surprised by those statistics. Yeah, here's a port in Shandong where we went. All these cranes here being used to unload these logs. I'd never seen a port like this. I think of Oakland as a large port. It's not. Not compared to other ports that I've seen since. It's just amazing. Predominantly logs from the United States and Russia here. And here you can see this is the log export going from 74 million feet in 2008 up to 666 million in 2010. Not nearly a significant improvement or increase in lumber because Canada has a much better ability to compete on lumber because Canadian lumber has a tariff coming into the U.S. It doesn't into Canada. And here, this is just saying essentially that we're going to probably see the same thing happen double again in 2011. And this is a Chinese sawmill. I mean, I saw numerous sawmills here. I mean, look at the safety gear. There are essentially two band mills. That's it. There were two motors in this sawmill. And but I went to one town in Shandong that had 500 of these. I mean, I didn't count them all, but that's what I was told. 500 sawmills. They were everywhere. But it just the level of sophistication is, I mean, they're making BMWs and Mercedes and they're living like this too. It's a real contradiction. This is another sawmill. Again, no waste conveyors. You shut down when there's too much sawdust and shovel it away and do that. This is our Chinese website. You can see this is a photo of our office. This is our website down here, some of our text. The only problem is it's not us. I mean, it's all copied. It's another deal of fraud. One of our customers found this on the internet and said, Christ, that looks like Sierra Pacific's office. Well, it is. And also, I don't think we'd call ourselves the American Music Jubilee Pacific Timber Company. And we haven't been in business 310 years. And I'd like to think we plant a lot of trees, but we don't plant 500 million a year. But anyway, it just is kind of a cultural issue dealing with China. And the Chinese. Anyway, so is China a threat or an opportunity? I think it's probably some of both. When we were there, about a third of the sawmills were shut down. They couldn't pay for those logs. So we found a little bit of comfort in that. And when you really crunch the numbers, you get all the way down to it. We were very competitive on our manufacturing costs. And also, they're different products. We're manufacturing a graded, on-size, dry product. they're manufacturing wood. I mean, that is about it. I mean, it's not graded, it's just, it's a different product. But anyway, I thought some of these pictures on pride on China would be kind of interesting. That pretty much concludes my presentation, but I just a very few final thoughts. Doesn't it make sense in California to intensively manage some of our land for forest products that we use here? I mean, California's just over 100 million acres, and shouldn't we take maybe 3 or 4% of this land and provide our own fiber under the most stringent rules? And we can do this while we're still providing habitat for the 256 different species that we've identified use our land. And shouldn't science rather than emotion play a major role in managing the landscape? Owning what we do is a major responsibility. And in my core, I believe that what we're doing is best possible job in managing our lands for our society and now and into the future. Thank you. Good.
What makes the 8-year-old section grow so fast?
Oh, it's, again, superior tree, proper spacing, access to sunlight. It's not rocket science. It really isn't. I mean, it's just that they're not so crowded. I mean, I'll bet you that there are areas, and 300 trees per acre is too many. When, at our final harvest, we want about 80. But there are stands in our national forests that probably have over 1,000 stems per acre. We have this series of photographs that are taken from about 100 years. And at the first photograph, you can see the horizon, you can see big trees. The photos taken now, you can't see 10 feet. And also, like I said, the species composition has also changed. And the trees are just stagnant. It's just like it's just proper spacing and the proper trees. We'll send the environmentalists and unions over there. No, you know, it's. I mean, that's a real valid question because, again, when I look at, like I say, their manufacturing plants, when they put their mind to doing something, they're tough to beat. We have to be competitive. I mean, we're. It's interesting where we are using technology to offset labor. I mean, the technology we use is expensive, it's complicated. We get rid of the $16 an hour guy and hire the $70,000 a year electrician. It's going to be a battle, you know, there's no doubt, but I think we're up for it.
Have you noticed any impact from natural disasters like the Japanese situation on your export market?
No, not yet. There hasn't been any. It's not for our company. I'd say that probably the biggest issue we have is our neighbors, which in a lot of cases, you saw the Santa Fe and many of the other acquisitions, those are checkerboarded. If you remember when the railroads come through, the government incented them in building and gave them alternating sections, horrible way to manage the landscape. That was a mistake. But the problem we have, I'd say, is our neighbors, where we are neighbors with the Forest Service who doesn't manage their lands. And fires start there and they go out of control. At this point, we've been lucky, haven't had any beetle kill on any of our lands of significance.
So if you had to take any direct action to combat forest health threats to your land so far?
Well, I'll tell you, we are aggressive when we find an infestation. We go and we frankly cut the hell out of it. I mean, we're gonna try to take care of our land. We're not gonna let these things get out of control. I was in Colorado a few months ago, drove from Denver over the pass to Vail in the summer. I couldn't believe the dead trees that were there. I mean, it's going to be a major fire. There's no doubt about it. On our lands, I mean, it really is interesting. You can see a bad tree, one tree this year, and you can see when they're dead. I mean, they get this red top in them, and they're infested with bugs. And, you know, the bugs send out pheromones or whatever, but, I mean, they'll call in other bugs. It goes from one tree to five trees to an acre to 20 acres. We get in and we aggressively manage it.
So the question is, how do you manage a forest without a sawmill? And as an economist, I'll
How do you manage a forest without a sawmill?
So your management and philosophy for the company is a little different than the trend in the forest products industry now in terms of control of strategic assets in the forest versus concentrating on forest ownership or industrial facilities.
Yeah, I mean, there really has been a shift. When you look at, again, the industrial ownership today, TIMOs, Timber Investment Management Organizations, are by far the largest owner of forests in the United States today. I hadn't even heard that term 20 years ago. I don't think they existed. And, you know, it's a relationship like this. If you don't have sawmills, what's your timber worth? I guess you can export it, but to rely upon that, I think is a little shaky. Without a doubt, even the guys up in Washington that own timberland, they were happy as heck when we went up there and added two mills. They're very, very pleased. In fact, our original relationship with Rainier, when we first went up to Washington, we signed a deal with Rainier where they would provide 40 million feet a year for 12 years, not free by any means, but at least we knew we had that as kind of the base supply. So I'd say that there are some of those long-term contracts that these some of the landowners have, and also export markets. Export markets very hot today. Well, I'm not sure what that means, but we have worked on some conservation easements. We have sold probably $15 million of conservation easements to the state of California up in the Tahoe area and some other areas. So we look at that. Another interesting one would be carbon, and that is, I think that's going to happen in 2012. I think that the Air Resources Board next week will adopt the final rules for implementation of the essentially the carbon aspect of AB 32. And we have an interesting deal with an outfit where we actually have agreed to sell 1.5 million tons of carbon to them. And boy, I'll tell you, that is like grabbing smoke. I mean, it comes down to the definitions and it is very complicated. Well, you know, I'd say that we've made plenty of mistakes, no doubt. We've made mistakes where we didn't listen enough to them, where we, to appease our critics. We listen to folks, but what's the basis? Is it that I don't like the way it looks? And that's often what it is. I mean, we're yet to find science that tells us what we're doing is wrong. And, you know, we look at a clear cut through human eyes. If you are a wood rat, you probably have a different view of that open space. I mean, you're not going to have a bunch of food for these forest carnivores, for owls, in a dark forest. We need a mosaic. I mean, you really do. This forest was never all old growth. I mean, do you think when we came here there were only old Indians? I mean, it's just ridiculous to think that the forests were just all old growth. It was never that way. There were always, it's a forest is dynamic. It's always changing. So would we, what was the exact question again? Okay, well, I mean, we need to listen to folks because, you know, life isn't just about science either. There is emotion. Sometimes I feel bad when, you know, I don't want to hide what we do, but we try to distinguish where the clear cuts are. People don't like to see them. But no.
No, so you're not going to end their cuts. You're not going to.
My God, do you really? I mean, why? Now, I would ask you that you really know what they intended. Well, you know, okay, hang on. I'm not going to respond if you don't stop talking. Okay. I think that you have to look at the science. If we're concerned, we're trying to bring back a forest that was occurring here 200 years ago. We're growing larger trees. again, when you look at this forest that was 20%, our forest say 20% pine when it used to be 80%, and the idea that we're going to stop clear cutting, I can't understand why. We're going to then take and harvest timber from other areas that have less stringent restrictions and put California workers out of business. You know, I haven't even mentioned that, but we have 3,600 employees. When you do the math on primary manufacturing, we probably have close to 100,000 people, I'm including families and everybody, that rely upon our company. So, you know, I think we're going to continue harvesting, and I'm very proud of what we do.
What's your view of the outlook for National Forest System lands in California being part of the timber base?
Well, I hope it's good. I mean, you know, we certainly, California's a tough place to operate. There's no question about it. I mean, having operations in Washington, it's really fascinating how the people look at the forestry different. Up in Washington, clear cuts are significantly larger, and we just don't get the same emotional response. It's a different place of doing business. But we're confident we'll continue to be in business in California.
So the question I had on the top of the stack here was, can you remain in California and be profitable?
Well, I can't tell the future, but you know, we're doing okay today. Boy, you know, I really don't know. I mean, there wouldn't be certainly any difference in the sawmills. I don't know that.
From all your acquisitions, which one worked out best? Which one didn't turn out the way you expected?
Probably the best was the Santa Fe. That really was a wonderful acquisition that we made. It was a big one. Again, it really was a bet the farm decision, and it turned out okay. I can think of some smaller ones that, boy, they were expensive, and we're still trying to pay those things off. But thank God it hasn't been a real big one. I mean, that's what I'd say, is that it's a competitive environment trying to purchase timberland, and we haven't made the big mistake yet. Environmental consulting companies. We certainly employ them, probably more in the areas of manufacturing sites than in forestry. But without a doubt, you know, wildlife biologists, GIS folks, I mean, there's going to continue absolutely to be a opportunity for that. I mean, it's probably in California you're better off because there's going to be more regulation here.
Fifty-six-year-old log.
Yeah, I mean, in all honesty, it probably depends on what you're using it for. If you're going to have a visual where you're going to see the wood, I'd want the older wood, without a doubt. But I'm not sure that we can afford to manufacture that and sell that. They're huge, without a doubt. I mean, that's, you know, I sincerely believe that it's kind of funny. What do you really own out there? Do you own the trees? Do you own the land? Do you own the animals? No, you don't. There's a lot of resources there that we have to take care of, without a doubt. I mean, I strongly believe that. The water, that's probably the biggest deal, is the water that comes on our lands. And it is impressive. I mean, we, you know, as far as having clean, cold water, we get a lot of allegations from, you know, folks that don't like what we do, that we damage the streams, and we just don't see it. I mean, we've spent millions and millions of dollars on studies. You know, I got a kind of a funny story. A gal who was a UC grad came to us now 15 years ago, and I believe when she came to us, She wanted to do her master's, I don't know if it was a PhD study or what, she's PhD now, but anyway, on her master's thesis on sedimentation in the creeks. And you can imagine us, a lumber company, you know, a Berkeley student wants to come and do a PhD. I mean, we looked through this and went, wait a minute, what are we getting into? But, you know, we talked to her, and anyway, so what we did is we paid for all the instrumentation. We laid out a bunch of instrumentation up very close to a river, and then we did harvesting. And she was ready to write her master's and tell us how bad we were. The problem was there was zero effect. It wasn't within the accuracy. Any change was not within the accuracy of the measuring devices. So then, you know, she kind of changed her view a little bit and said, you know, maybe these guys aren't. Maybe I'm not talking to Darth Vader here. So now she's worked for us, and we've got a special permit from CDF to cut right up to a creek. I mean, this is for scientific purposes. We cut right up to it to try to measure the change in the quality of the water and the temperature, and it was minimal. I mean, and this, you know, it's a peer-reviewed study. You know, I got to apologize. I'm not a forester. I can't tell you exactly what we're using. But I know as far as collecting these samples is very complicated. It's not easy to do. You don't just go out there and stick a jar in the water, which some of the folks that, you know, I mean, we have, again, this is overseen by our PhD scientist. And I'd be happy to get more information to the folks who are interested in that. I really would. But I'm afraid I can't answer that. I don't know. Well, maybe some folks have a different view now, but here anyway, it's complicated. I mean, look at as a citizen today, look at all the stuff we get bombarded with from the internet, through all these ads, everything. To really understand forestry, I mean, I didn't give it enough justice here today. It's more complicated than that. You know, I got in an argument with an environmentalist, if you can believe that. And we were talking, and I said, "What is your?" You know, why do you think you know anything about this? And the person said, you know, I live next to a forest. I said, okay. Is that how you select your doctor? And I'll tell you, the human body is complicated, but so is the forest. It is not something that you can just educate people on in 20 minutes. It is a very complex subject. It's a very good question. That's probably one of the biggest issues facing our industry is people don't understand it. And they think, you know, I mean, everyone, you know, save a tree. Well, hey, okay, that's, you know, I don't want to cut all the trees down, but if they're pulling out carbon dioxide of the atmosphere and we put it in long-term products, maybe that's okay. It's a very difficult chore. How do we accomplish it? I don't know. We've tried. There's been national programs. It's expensive, though. You know, trying to educate Californians. I mean, look at the elections. Look how much money's thrown around. And you get these 30-second sound bites of, you know, how can you determine who you're going to vote for in 30 seconds? How are we going to educate people on forestry? It's very complicated. I wish I knew.
Thank you very much for your time.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate all your time.